try to put some of the key features, plenty more, which obviously all of these are available in documentation for you. So without further delay, so again, it's a powerful statement for us. I would definitely be covering most of the 643 items for you, along with an 18C features. But as I start talking about it, there might be some capabilities that I would say are coming in future releases and so on. So from that context, this is a powerful statement. This is the agenda for next 1 hour, 50 minutes, and then we would have some Q&A. We will start with the user experience area. Again, if you remember a year back, people who would have attended others, their presentations used to have usability as a key pillar, a focus area where we want.
Going to talk about the features that are added into this release. Again, on the cloud side, we started with 643, 641, 642, and now 18C. As we speak, 18C has been started rolling out, and 18C is nothing but all the capabilities that you see in 643 on-prem. That's exactly the features that you will see in 18C, plus some enhancements, not enhancement, but bug fixes sort of thing. Again, to check on releases, Derek introduced yesterday on Oracle release namings, calling it 18A, B, C, and so on, in line with other products across. Any new cloud customers purchasing or buying OTM / GTM, this is what will be installed for them, will be available for them. Also, we have started upgrading all our 642 cloud customers, all of them right now on 642, and we are going to migrate them to 643, which is nothing but 18C again. And the process have been already started mid of last month, and it would go a couple of months into future as well to complete all the upgrades for all the existing customers who are on 642. Then you would we would come up with 18D, more about a security fixes only release, as we say. And we would upgrade from 18C to 18D and so on. And the next major release would be 19A, with a lot of functions, features, and new enhancements that you would see into the product. And then it will be followed with 19B and so on. Again, most of you who are familiar with OTM on an on-prem and using scalability, which we refer it as SCA, which is more about scaling across your workload across two different app servers and so on, that currently doesn't exist in cloud. And we are going to look at the possibility of adding that capability back. Then in the major 18-19 release, our major focus has always been to see if it can reduce the downtime that you would see with every upgrade or a patching process that you would have seen before. So, and we are trying to see if we can go to a near zero downtime as part of your upgrade and patching. So, these were the key focuses with respect to release within the cloud product. So I'll jump on some of the user experience enhancements. This is a new user interface design. Most of you who are on 642 and higher, you would have seen this very slight couple of times already. The same look and feel, and all about Hamburg's homepage, navigation, global search. So I'm not going to talk exactly on this, but in and around this, what were the enhancements that were added? So it's the same look and feel, but there are more enhancements that has been added to the product. So let's start with a global search. In the previous screen, you have shown a top, there is a search. Now, what we are given is a navigation search. As you can see on the right, somebody is typing just a shipment, and we display all the navigations related to shipment. It could be a buy shipment, sell shipment, shipment groups, and all that. So these are nothing but the menu links that you would typically go into the whole drill down of the menu and then go there. But now you can directly search by typing in just the description. Again, to this list, the power datas, which are basically very hidden stuff, which sometimes you may not know or figure out, but that's an easy way to do that. Then the saved searches, a lot of you would have created while using your finders related to different business objects. There are a lot of saved searches that you create and reuse them quite often, and all that can also be popped up just from that particular search. So it just like a name, you type in and any relevance with that name in your search naming, it will pop up for you. And you can see here, there is an option to switch on this, which is at a user level, user preference level. You can switch on saying that, do I need my saved searches to be part of the global search? So that's the option that is available at the user preference level. We will also see in the next slide about how to quickly search objects, which is a shipment objects of such a nature. So that's another capability that has been added. So this is one example where somebody is searching on an order and you're seeing the navigation save searches. So far so good here, but now you have added a new capability wherein you can say, most of you might be familiar, something called as user access. Which user has access to a certain set of menus or certain set of actions? The same way, you can say for this global search, which user has what access? And here you can see in this global search, you can say a user has a search option for an order release or a shipment, nothing else. So even though I search, if it is there on an invoice, it will not come up here. I'm searching for some number or something. So here the focus, we are restricting to that user to this particular UIs or the screen sets or the finders that we refer. So that's what you're seeing here. And this can be linked up to a role level also, or indirectly to a user level. So that's the new capability that has been added here. And based on that definition, now if you see there is an order, we saw navigation listed, order release lines, you also see searches with that name matching. But now you also see orders, literally. These are the order numbers, these are the objects that you are able to search. You don't have to literally go to the finder to all that. So that's much powerful for you. And again, on this search, on the extreme left, you can see, as part of user access, I defined an order release of domestic US, let's say. So I'm looking for all the orders as part of my search only into that particular region, or it could be outside of US. So I can have a two finders, and if you remember, whoever are used to OTM, as part of the screen set, you can define defaults on a particular field as a criteria whenever you search using that finder, the defaults. So that defaults come into play, and that's how you can narrow it down. So if I search orders, it shows by order release with that order matching all the shipments which are outside of US and all the orders, basically all the orders which are into the US itself, within US itself. So that's another, here it is a search by CATH or CATH, and you get as part of this finder as well as this within shipment also if there is matching and so on. So it's basically an object level search rather than just a navigation or save query. So that eases how you navigate. You don't have to do multiple clicks to reach there, but very quick way to do all your work. Further moving on the notification, as you can see on the overall interfaces, initially where one option was home page, global search, and then you have a notification. So now what we have added is, in case there are notification, there would be a badge that would be shown. So that's an indication there's something that you would have to look into it. So that's one add-on, and just like you want to view your notification in new pop-up of what type of notifications. And similarly, business monitor, this was available before you defined all your saved queries, based on which you monitor if there are exceptions that I want to pay attention to, and that's the whole picture of your business monitor. And the look and feel has been now changed to new so-called theme that we started introducing in 6.4. And then you have favorites. This is again, you can mark a certain set of objects as your favorites and so on, and that could be switched on a screen set level, so that this also comes into play for you. This is what we call springboard. It's a navigation. In this example, you can see there is a menu, main menu called classification, and inside which you have trade agreements, classification, lookups, and so on. So you would have navigated all the way and trying to do something. Now suddenly you want to click on a home page. Everything goes away for you. It becomes, you have to start drilling down right from start till this point. The now the system would keep this state, and whenever you return back on a home, it could land up to this. So your state is retained, you don't have to. So all these are usability point of view, this would help you much better. Again, you can add new menus or group links, this might be a group link, the master data could be a group link, you can add new group links. You can change your icons of the group link as you like. So these are some options that have come up on the spring. Again, on the branding and the theme, we now have an option to change the background color as well as the URL which would depict. So all this could be, whatever I'm talking, could be done directly via the UI itself. Some of the features of on-prem, you've got to do with the file system and all that. Nothing of that nature is required. So here is another example. This is how you could do your theme management or a branding stuff with the logos and change your background colors and all that. Okay, the next area again within usability is the social panel. What this does is it helps you to start a conversation from OTM between two different users, and that we are trying to achieve that with the cloud and content and experience cloud integration that we have between OTM and the content and experience cloud. And you can use, just as you log in within OTM, you are directly logged in. Only thing is that you got to map the user of an OTM with the user of the content and via the nickname. Those who are familiar with user management, where you define all your OTM users, there's a nickname. And again, the nickname is not just here, but the nickname gets used with all your SSO logins that you use on cloud. So that's how the mapping between a user with a mail ID login is managed with respect to an OTM user. So you can see this can be by default switched off. This is switched off, but you can get this panel just by switching on a property. So you get this panel and you start conversation, and it starts showing what are the conversation you started and what you're following it up, or what are your favorite conversation in that and so on. Yes, we would spend more time on this later on giving a conversation at an object level as well. So you can say, on this shipment, I'm talking to my other department, and you start conversation at an object reference level also. We'll come to that. Now I'm going into the workbench. Yesterday, a lot of presentations, and all these presentations I could see were using workbench a lot, which is great to see. It's a powerful UI. And towards in the very workbench, we have added further more capabilities. for you to take advantage of. As you can see, by default, the screen set which are all the finders that you are referring, or the finder results that you see as part of your workbench, one of the panels or layout. There are options like sorting, actions, smart link, favorites, which were available on the normal finder. Now all these are again available on your workbench. So our workbench does show up all this. You can sort within a workbench in a particular grid which is built based on the finder. You can sort them. You can do a smart link from just from there. So all these which were existing in default, we started adding. The next one improvement is refreshing. One item, let's say I have a workbench with two layouts, the parent and the child layout. If I run some actions on a parent, maybe child is getting changed. Yeah? I do some order, I have orders and then I say build shipment, or I change some details in an order that has to reflect on the shipment which is on the below. So now what we have done is when you run certain actions which have impact on the child also gets refreshed for you. You don't have to hit a refresh button on the child to get that detail. So in a run back, then we have supported this drag and drop feature which was available for few objects. Now we have started, you can take a driver and assign it to a shipment, or you can say I have an order or an order movement I want to add it to an existing shipment just by drag and drop on your workbench and so on. So that's possible. We have also started supporting the inline editing within this. So you can make a more inline editing within this. You don't have to click a detail page to open up and then enter and then finish. But if that very finder results, you can do your inline. As long as the number of fields are within that panel, you can easily do that. That's on inline editing here. Again, this morning we also talked about user access given at an object level or a screen set level for a global search. In similar lines, we had workbenches, but you can say a certain type of workbenches can be used by a certain users or a certain role. So now we have introduced this workbench layout as an option as part of your user access. So here you can see at the bottom that particular user access, you can say include all the layouts except the following. So you're giving more power. So this could be done at a role or at a user level, just as we do for other business, other functions with respect to user management. Another options here on the mapping action. So if you remember, this existed long back, old days as well. So you can take a certain set of shipments and say, map this shipment on a map, basically. So you can say 3-4 shipments and all that. All that was built on the advanced layouts, and we have now replaced that with a workbench. So what it will happen is if you run those actions, it would pop up a workbench for you. So you run that action, the actions could be like, for example, I'm on a location, I say, show me or map all the inbounds to this location. So that's one of the examples of how it was built, and now it's, that part is being replaced with the workbench UIs. With all, not just the graphs, maybe you'll see some examples of that, but that's the intent here. And we also started shipping few of the public's workbenches for you to use them, which we think are very common use cases for everybody. So we are shipping 7 to 8 workbenches as by default with the product, which you can start using that. So this is another map action. If you see here at the bottom, you can see near view shipment layouts. So this is a logic config which is there, which will tell you if you run a particular action, like on a location there was an action called for this location, all the inbounds, for this location, all the outbounds, there was action. This is the place where you can say for that action, what is your, and the parameter value, you will link up a workbench basically. And this is default we give it, you can customize that as you like it or change within the workbench, a lot of configuration, you can change that, but these are defaults that we ship. So for all this, these are the corresponding defaults workbenches that we have started providing. There's one example where we say move orders to shipment optimization, that's the action you run, but the output you could see in this fashion. So it's more, not just it has added, but it would also show the available shipments into this and the order release that was being on which the action was run and so on. This is another example. You have bulk, fleet bulk plan, and you want to put that into your work, the results of how it had, what orders it took, what, or in this case, it would be more drivers and shipment assignment linkages. So that's what this is depicting, and then visually you could see in a graph and then a Gantt chart of the driver also comes. So such actions are now backed with the workbenches, and anybody using your advanced layout, it is strongly recommended you move from that to an advanced layout going forward. This is another example. On the location, you say map shipments. So the list of shipments for that location is listed, and then in this case, there might be multiple locations that has been selected, and that's how this is being depicted here. Here is another example of a public workbench that we are shipping, which is a restricted party screening. This is more a GTM function area. So on the top, and what we have tried to do is, as part of the work assignment, we have given more options of drag and drop shipments to be to a new time slot within an assignment. So you can see this at the bottom, there are two work assignments. You can drag an existing shipment onto, so you have a shipment, but I want to put it as part of the work assignment, I just drag it, and put it into this Gantt chart view so that it fits into the time slot also and starts redriving accordingly. So that's some options I added. Again, as you hover over these small shipment representations on this work assignment, you can get more details. So you can switch on your screen sets. So this option is also added. So you, as you hover, you get more additional context information. So these are all some of the features that we have added in usability. We will move on to into the transportation area further. One of this use case is this high volume lines. So there are instances where we are seeing there are sales orders with a lot of lines in it, but those lines are from a sales point of view, but from a transportation you may not need those much lines. You might want to have it reduced lines. And from a transportation, we don't really care about all those items. That should not be a focus. And in such cases,
thanks, Ashok. A brief introduction about me is I'm working with Oracle from the last 10 years, working for Oracle Transportation Management. And our team mainly, my team mainly takes care of the sourcing, rate maintenance, execution, and fleet areas. Okay. And today, now I'm going to talk about what we have addressed in the 6.4.3 on-prem release and 18 cloud release. And main feature, actually this was developed in 6.4 release, and it is fleet aware buckler, FABP we will call it as. And prior to this feature, actually we still have this continuous moves. Continuous moves is nothing but stringing of the shipments to form a tour based on some criteria like the distance. If I want to save some cost in stringing the shipments which are close by. So that is continuous moves concept. Since that continuous moves is not supported for the assignment of the driver, tracking, etc. So we went for this fleet aware bulk plan. So this enables the customers who are like distribution center basic, which who can effectively manage their private and dedicated fleet. When there are daily operations, they have to plan large number of fleets, right? they will go for the split aware bulk plan. So first we define the resource schedules. What is the resource schedule is like, I have a set of drivers who are starting at the same location at the same time. And based on some calendars, like a calendar is nothing but at what time they can start and what are the business days they operate. So I'll associate a calendar to the resource schedule. And based on this, I'll generate a resource schedule instance. Actually, resource schedule is a template kind. This is not how many drivers are available on a particular day. So you just define a template, which is nothing but the resource schedule. And based on the calendar you attach, you generate the instances, 10th to 15th. And with a count of, like, resource schedule has a count of 3, means like daily 3 drivers are starting of location like Philadelphia at 10 o'clock. And duration I'll mention, that is 1 day duration. They'll start at 10 o'clock and they'll come back next day at 10 o'clock. So this, I have the resources available, right? I know daily I have a fleet of 3 drivers starting at 10 o'clock and who has to complete their trip and come back to the home location or whatever location, but next day 10 o'clock. And I'll give this information to the shipments in the bulk plan. So what happens in the bulk plan is like at the end of the shipment's creation, we will try to string them based on some criteria, like what should be the maximum distance between the shipments and what should be the time duration between the shipment pickups. So based on that, I'll string the shipments. To that string, I'll be associating a resource schedule instance. Okay, resource schedule, in that case, work assignment is a unit of work that can be assigned to any driver for that day. So this is the brief concept of the fleet aware bulk plan. Yeah, and this is the slide which explains like what's resource schedule instances. And actual work assignment is, I told you, like it's unit of work. And when you create a work assignment, it is not the driver is not assigned to that actually. Just you know that one count is assigned. I have a 3 fleet, 3 count of the drivers. Then I can assign 1 driver to the work assignment. See in the below screen, you can see the string of the shipment, like 4 shipments are existing in this work assignment. And the resource schedule instance is like daily from Philadelphia to Philadelphia, 5 drivers will be starting at 10 o'clock. Okay, if you see all these shipments are very close by. So this driver can pick up the shipment 14007 and come drop it, again pick up this 72 shipment, and like the 74 is the last shipment which has to be dropped. And we are mentioning that what's the duration of the shipment, what's the weighted cost, something. Just like how many maximum numbers of shipments I can put it in a work assignment. And minimum shipments, what the cost savings I'm going to, what the cost tolerance. And what are the enhancements we have done as part of the 643 and 18 is, we are rationalizing the work assignment resourcement life cycle. Because see in the bulk plan, you are giving the information that daily 3 count is there. Okay, and the 1 work assignment is created against 1 resource count. So you have to reduce that count, right? Because already 1 is there, so 2 count is available for the next stringing. So that we are decrementing on the each creation of the work assignment. And another, as Ashok explained, the drag and drop facility. So next slide, I'll show you the work assignment workbench. So actually, see the shipment, the system gave the work assignment, sorry, shipment sequence as 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Suppose user wants to move the 2 shipment up, he wants to change the sequence. Or maybe he wants to move a shipment from one work assignment to the other. So instead of selecting that shipment and executing the action, remove the shipment and add it to the next shipment, in the work assignment where user can, sorry, in the workbench where user can perform all the actions at a time at a single place, we have added this work assignment also as a layout in the workbench. And when and the other is like disbanding the shipments. What is meant by disbanding is you are delinking the shipments from the work assignment. Okay, you have to select the work assignments and say disband. So there are no more stringing actually. You are removing the shipments from the work assignment. That action also we are supporting as part of this workbench enhancements. And so deep, and we have done some DPO improvements also, like performance. A DPO is I have a set of shipments, I have the set of drivers. Say, assume you have 100 shipments, you have some 20 drivers. You can't manually assign drivers to the each shipment, right? So we will give the shipments query, that is set of shipments and available drivers, and we will run this fleet bulk plan. in one of the slides earlier, Ashok explained it. So fleet bulk plan. So this set of drivers will be assigned to the shipments based on some criteria, like how many shipments at a time driver can take. So that is in a string, the driver assignment. So around that, we have some problems like in the algorithms. When we were using some cost-based save algorithm, right? And if the car count is increasing, like shipment count is more, then that was taking a lot of time. So we have done some improvements on the DPO. And this is the work assignment workbench. See, you can see, basically this has two tables. One is the shipment table and the work assignment, and below is the Gantt. Okay, see here, this work assignment bottom one contains 70 and 71. And the first work assignment contains 75 and 71. See, this last shipment, which is 74, I guess, I can move it to this work assignment. Simply drag it and put it here. Okay, that way, you are not executing any action, remove the shipment from the current work assignment and assign it. So what happens is, actually, when you do these actions, the shipment has to be redriven, right? See, the shipment sequence the system gave us 1, 2, 3, 4, the 2 has to be picked up after the first shipment. But once you change the sequence, the shipment has to be redriven. So this also automatically happens in this drag and drop. User has no need to explicitly do that. And similarly, you can remove the shipments. Just take the shipment and put it back in this shipment table set. Yeah, and this location capacities check also we have addressed in the work assignment creation. What's the location capacity is, I can define some constraints on the, at the location level, mentioning that what kind of or what amount of work can be done. For example, dock door is there. At a time, only one shipment can be picked up or received at a particular dock door. Or some weight constraints also there. I can't receive more than some 20,000 ALB at a particular dock door. Earlier, prior to 643, we were not having that check in the work assignment creation. See, in this example, assume that location 2 has a constraint that at every hour it can receive only one or only one shipment can be picked up. So prior to this enhancement, first you can see this, I have two work assignments, shipment 1 and shipment 2 in that string. And the second work assignment, shipment 3 and shipment 4, but locations are same. Okay, shipment 1, location 1 to location 2, and shipment 3, location 1 to 2. Shipment 2 will be location 2, 3. Shipment 4, location 2 to 3. In that, location 2 is the drop location at the work assignment, shipment 1, and pickup location at the shipment 2. And similarly, in the second work assignment also. Okay, before work assignment, before this enhancements, you can see that work assignment, shipment 1 is picked up at 12 a.m. and dropped at 3:20. And shipment 2, at the same time, it's picked up. But your capacity or your constraint is, at every hour, only one shipment can be picked up or dropped, right? So you are violating that capacity. You are not checking that constraint there. If you observe that, say, shipment 2 is dropped at, say, picked up at 3:28, whereas shipment 1 is also picked up and dropped at 3:28 only. If you see the second one, that is after this enhancement, in the work assignment 2, the shipment 3 is picked up at 1:31 and dropped at 5 a.m. Instead of 3:28 a.m., now its times are changed. You can see that, right? So this is the enhancement we have addressed in the 643. Yeah, and we have this driver shifts actually. When we assign a driver to shipments, right, after the second shipment, he can stay, either he can stay at the shipment end location, or he can go back to the hometown. Okay, I assigned a driver for today, and up this end location, for example, New York, but his hometown is Philadelphia. At the end of the shipment, he'll be staying at the New York only. So next day, when I assign a different shipment, he will be starting from today's, that is current shipment's end location. So he'll be staying at the end location for the whole night, and the next day he'll be starting, he'll be from the previous shipment's location. So to address this, we have come up with a shift based. So we assign the driver some shifts, like within this shift, if he is getting shipments, then he does not, he'll not go back to the home term. If he, after the shift, he got a new assignment, then he won't pick up that assignment. He will go back to the home, and next day, as per his shift, he'll start the new assignment. So we have added a, see in this example, you can see the default home location as a Philadelphia for this particular driver, and we enhance this work profile section. Here I'm giving the driver shift as a 6 p.m. to 2 p.m. So he can do the service only from 6 p.m. to 2 p.m. If I'm assigning any shipment, and if he's completing the shipments, he'll be staying back at the shipments location only. He won't go back to the home term. Okay, if he is getting any shipment after the shift, after 2 o'clock, then he goes back, and next day he'll pick up the shipment. And see, this is the before assignment driver. Here in the screen, I'm going to assign a driver, that's a previous driver who has the shift of 6 p.m. to 2 p.m. You can see that all the shipments are starting at 9:30 a.m. On December 1st. Okay. And all are smaller, like duration only. One is less than 2 hours. 2 hours duration shipments. But earliest pickup is 9:30. But this driver's shift starts at 6 o'clock. Okay. So when I assign the, you can see the shipment stops as no NFR stops. Okay. I'm assigning the driver first to the first shipment. So he, though this, his shift starts at 6 o'clock, but the shipment can't start at 6 o'clock, right? Earliest start time is 9:30. So he'll come to this Philadelphia, sorry, King of Persia location at 9:30, and he picks up this one. Then next shipment is, and he drops it 11:20. This is within the shift, right? So next shipment when I assigned, that is 6-3 shipment, since that is within the shipment, within the shift, he won't go back to the home term. He will start from the Newark itself. So at present, after dropping the shipment, he is at Newark. So from Newark, he comes to the Newark, then picks up the shipment. So we'll see for the third shipment how the locations are changed. This is after assignment. Okay, if you see the first screen, Philadelphia is added at the first stop. Earlier screen, if you observe, only 2 stops were there, right? King of Persia is the shipment's first, that's the drop, pickup point, and the Newark is the drop point. In this screen, you can see for the same shipment, Philadelphia. Philadelphia is the home location of the driver. So he is coming from Philadelphia, he's starting at Philadelphia at 8:56, come to the King of Persia, which is closer, okay, and drop the shipment at Newark. Okay, and for the next, since this is, he is dropping at 11:21, before 2 p.m. He's not going back to the hometown, which is Philadelphia. For the second shipment, you can see Newark is added. In the earlier screen, only 2 stops were there for the second shipment too. See, if you see that one, for the second shipment, Newark is there, right? But in the second screen, you can see the Newark is added. Newark is the last shipment's drop point. So since the driver is starting at the Newark for the next shipment, Newark is added as the NFR stop. Then he'll come to the Newark and drop the shipment. See, when he is dropping the second shipment at 5 o'clock, it is after the shift. So he goes back to the Philadelphia. Since the shift is got over, right? So he'll go back to the Philadelphia, and from Philadelphia, he's starting the next day. Because for that day, shift is completed. So next day, that's why this shipment's time is moved to the 2nd of December. See this one. In this, the third shipment is starting at first, that's before the driver assignment. In the second screen, you can see that the shipments dates are pushed to 2nd December. So this is based on the shifts. And we have addressed this, in DPO functionality also, because you have the drivers who are working on the shifts, and this workers, and you have the shipments. Okay, you are giving this query, so system automatically checks for the driver shifts, and based on that, it will string the shipments and assign the drivers. Yeah, and this is Fleet mobile app. Actually, this is also an existing feature in 6.4.3 or 18 cloud. We enhance this more for the driver user. So who can perform these scenarios? Like whenever he gets assignments, right, he logs into the mobile app, and he can confirm the shipments. Then message goes to the carrier, and then start the shipments, adds events that he arrived at the source location, picked up this and complete, dropped at the destination, completed the shipment and signature and photo capture. These are the main enhancements that were done in the driver mobile. So these are the like springboards that are supported. So see in the screen you can see he already confirmed the shipments that was assigned to him. So when he then when he clicks on the confirmation, right, so current shipment will be selected here. So when he selects the see here we are showing like what are the total shipments that are assigned to him, confirmed and completed also. So when he goes to the when he starts the shipment, right, first he checks what are the stop details, what are the shipment details, everything. So he can go to the shipment details tab. See in the stops you can see this New York, it's not yet started, Boston, it's not yet started. Then times also displays. Then he goes to shipment details and say the start the shipment. Okay, and in this he can add the event. He picked up the shipment at particular location on some date. So based on that OTM will send the events to the OTM. Based on that the status will be changed, like en route started, en route delayed, if it is delayed, en route completed. And apart from this, we have done this some bulk plan enhancements also. A main area was like a diagnostics. We improved the diagnostics. Earlier we were showing the tree view kind of diagnostics, like when user is selecting the orders and planning, they are failed, but user does not know why they are failed. See, in bulk plan we have different stages like order bundling, itinerary selection, then network routing, rates. So we don't know like whether rates are not existing on that particular itinerary, network, like itinerary selection is not there. So we used to support the tree view, which is like vague and all. So for the more user friendly, we added the diagnostics, like graphical diagnostics also. We'll see in the upcoming screens what are the different views we are supporting. And apart from termination, like when you have like a big volume of data that is submitted for the bulk plan, you wanted to terminate that one. There are some stages where user can terminate it. For example, when order bundling happens, he can terminate. But during the commit, he can't terminate. So we have added that kind of termination checkpoints where user can terminate. And this, when you have a single leg shipment, right, there is no need to iterate that routing. It's a direct shipments kind of, so we are bypassing that one also. Okay, and we are supporting three views like block view, sunburst view and text view. In the upcoming screen you can see. Now the text view is the earlier one where you can see the tree structure kind. If you go to the performance tab and enable the diagnostics, you can see some itineraries, this many set of itineraries were satisfied doing the order bundling, this many rates existing like that. And color coding also we have added. And this another enhancements we have added around the loading pattern. Actually, load config is like a graphical representation or 3D representation of how you are going to put your packed stuff on the container or the trailer, right? So you don't know how, when you place this packed one on the container, how it looks like, how effectively you can place it. There are some different patterns so that you are utilizing the space optimally. So now we are supporting the cylinder as a pattern. So you have big coils that have to be shipped on the flatbed container, right? So how you can you can put that big cylinder first on the center or left corner. So you can mention during our order creation, you can mention that pattern details, where to put. Okay, and the other one is tolerance. Earlier, like your item should exactly match the pattern dimensions. For example, you have an item which is 27, but the pattern is 30. You have still the 3 mm or 3 inches tolerance, right? Since it checks the exact match, it was not allowing that item to be put in that pattern. But now if you define a 10 tolerance, it will allow the item to be placed on that pattern. But this is only the lower level. If the pattern is 30 mm size, but item is 27, it allows. But if it is 33, it won't, because you can't put the higher item on the lower pattern, right? And this is the, we support a tolerance. See, this is one example I was telling. you have the packaged item as steel coil. So for normally you will be placing that in the center of the trailer, right? If you are placing on the left, balance will not be there. So you have to mention whether you are placing it on the center, left corner or right corner. So these are all will come under during the order creation, that in the shipment you will go to the what pattern it has to be used during the ship unit building. And this is the like we are supporting the dunnage also. Dunnage is like packing stuff or supporting stuff we use. See, if you see this dunnage, it's you are putting at the corners so that you are directly not contacting with the trailers. But these are not the actual item we are shipping. Okay, so when you define an order, you have to mention that what kind of dunnage you are using, whether it's not whether it's a dunnage item or not. So you were when you were packing, right, it allows the space for the dunnage also. Okay, these are all the enhancements as part of 643. I'll hand over. Thank you.
That